Brick by Brick Audiobooks presents The Hike by Landon Beach, Book 4 in the Great Lakes Saga, read for you by Scott Brick. For Eric, Deity, and Jim, Sui Generis, friends who have hiked many miles of life with me. You call that murder? Well, I see murder too. Not written on those drowned faces out there, but on the faces of dead thousands. They are the assassins, the dealers in death. I am the avenger. Do you know the meaning of love, Professor? What you fail to understand is the power of hate. It can fill the heart as surely as love can. But there is hope for the future. When the world is ready for a new and better life, all this will someday come to pass. In God's good time. Captain Nemo, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. If possible, you should always touch the body with your gun to make sure the man is dead. Man is the hardest animal to kill. If he gets away, he will come back to kill you. Salvatore Maranzano, first capo di tutti capi of the 5 New York families. When they come, they'll come at what you love. Michael Corleone, The Godfather, Part 3. Where is good? In our reasoned choices. Where is evil? In our reasoned choices. Where is that which is neither good nor evil? In things outside of our own reasoned choice. Epictetus, Discourses, 2:16. One. Prologue 1, Springer Mountain, Georgia, Saturday, April 4th, 2015. Rays of golden sunlight found their way easily through the bare gray tree trunks rising toward the sky as Brad Cranston stood in front of the stone archway that marked the start of the Appalachian Approach Trail. Last night, he had stayed at Amicalola Falls Lodge and been told by the front desk clerk that in a few months, the surrounding woods would be a lush green canopy of tree leaves. However, in April, it was as if nature refused to leave a deep winter depression, and only a skeleton of the once vibrant woods remained with human beings hiking around her weathered bark bones looking for flesh. Brad couldn't argue with the description, but he did see scattered patches of foliage, signifying that the forest was coming back to life and that spring was here, and summer was right around the corner. After a chilly morning with temperatures in the low 40s, Brad's watch said the temperature was now in the upper 50s. Dressed in a red, long-sleeved, moisture-wicking Columbia shirt with tan Columbia pants and leather L.L. Bean Cresta hiking boots, he turned his 46-year-old body away from the stone archway, and a beam of sun shone on his face. He enjoyed the momentary warmth and then took a couple of steps forward, then stopped and scanned the faces of the half-dozen hikers wearing bright-colored windbreakers and lugging huge backpacks heading his way. They passed by him, stabbing the earth with their trekking poles, without offering any greetings and without much chatter between them, seemingly lost in their thoughts about the task that lay ahead. Some earlier hikers had been louder, cracking jokes and laughing to ease the tension, which he had settled on as a strategy to use with his own hiking partner. He looked at his watch. It was 1 p.m., They were supposed to meet near the arch at noon. Brad's hiking partner, his lovable screw-up of a younger brother Conrad, was still nowhere to be seen. Brad pivoted and watched the hikers go under the arch. For a while, he could hear the sound of the group's boots cracking the scattered branches on the floor of the trail. But soon the cracks and snaps faded until all he could hear was the occasional buzzing of the few bugs that had dared to brave the cooler April temperatures. For the 20th time today, Brad looked at the red sign with white letters next to the arch, signifying the beginning of the approach trail. 8.5 miles later was the official start of his 2,181-mile Appalachian Trail, AT hike with Conrad. If all went well, they'd summit Mount Katahdin in Maine's Baxter State Park and hug the sign on Baxter Peak sometime in September or early October. Months had gone into their preparation, all leading to today, day one. He had picked the approach trail as their start, instead of being dropped off where Forest Service Road 42 intersected the trail less than a mile into the AT. If Conrad, the king of shortcuts, had known about this option, he would have demanded that they start there. Brad figured the 8.5-mile approach trail would be an easy test to see if Conrad was serious or not. Once Conrad started something he was interested in, he had a surprising amount of drive and resiliency, which had been a powerful advantage at a few brief points during his life, and a debilitating liability during other stretches. They were from Michigan, so a handful of Michigan state parks had been their training ground for day hikes to get them in shape and get them used to carrying the load they would hump with on the trail. They had scaled up to overnighters and performed equipment research and testing, read a dozen books about the trail, including Bryson's inspirational account, and finally tackled logistics planning. Their support person would be their sister Heidi, and she had bump boxes containing specific items to replenish their supplies, all addressed and ready to send to them as they reached certain towns. Brad reasoned that if they failed, it wouldn't be because of a lack of preparation. In fact, they were so prepared that he was seeing visions of toilet paper, duct tape, and half-toothbrushes on the wall at night, including his stay last night at the comfortable lodge. He'd invited Conrad to fly into Atlanta with him, ride to the lodge, and stay with him there so they could start hiking in the morning, but his brother had declined. "Look, I'll be standing with you under the stone arch at high noon, all right? Don't get all uptight on me. Let things flow," he had said. Like always, there had been no changing his mind. Brad looked at his watch again. 1:15 p.m. Another group of hikers, louder than the one he had just seen disappear into the woods, passed by and stopped by the arch to have their pictures taken before embarking on their journeys. Thankfully, they did not ask for his help. He must have seen over 50 people already and helped most of them with their pictures. "Hello, sir. Could you help us take a quick picture?" Where in the hell was Conrad? That was the most pressing question. Another question slithering around in Brad's mind was, why am I doing this? He'd been divorced for 5 years, so this wasn't a knee-jerk escapist mission. He was relatively happy in life, so this wasn't an I've-got-to-go-find-myself remedy. He had never been out of shape, and so this wasn't some crusade with echoes from a doctor's physical examination that said, lose the weight or else. He hadn't succumbed to materialism, so the hike was not to get away from the empty distractions and excesses that contemporary life in America offered at every turn. Why am I here? His best answer was that he had helped his brother turn his life around. They had both always been the outdoors type. They enjoyed each other's company, and although Conrad was much more competitive than he was, they liked a challenge. Any other positive that this half a year provided would be welcomed but not required. What will the rest of the world be doing for the next 6 months? Standing here, pissed off, waiting for Conrad, Brad Cranston decided that he didn't really care. He moved away from the archway and took a seat far enough away to not be asked for any more picture assistance. He'd give Conrad another half hour or so, then he'd hike back up to the lodge and start making phone calls. "Don't start playing the what-if game," he told himself. He picked up a twig from the ground and started bending it, testing its pliability. On the third bend, it snapped in two. He threw the pieces down. Okay, what have I missed here? He searched his memory for any hints that Conrad would be a no-show. All of the milestones that, if not taken care of, would have triggered Conrad's early exit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.